Here we go.
Cosby do a picture page with you. We rolling. Let's go.
All right, so just introduce yourself.
Man, to people at home in Winston-Salem, I'm known by Pooh. to my teachers and friends, you know, through elementary and middle and high school, I'm known by Patrick. You know, the R-I-C-K got cut off when I got to college. It was mainly Pat. Then I had friends that called me P. Then, you know, it turned into Knife. So, Knife Wonder, Grammy Award-winning producer, DJ, college professor, member of the University of Zulu Nation, husband, father, CEO of IWWMG, ambassador for NAACP. Friend, enemy of some, but that's who I am. I make life music, man. I don't make music just for the club or make music just for reading. I make music for life. And I also make music that producers and people that don't understand production can understand. You have some producers to make beats just for producers. Ooh, I chopped this sample and ooh. So such and such can be wild or another producer can be wild. That's great. And then you have some producers that make music just for to make somebody dance or, you know, the beat is so stripped down that it's just for the people can understand or the people can, a person can sit down like, I can make a beat like that. I try to stay in the middle. To make music that your average cat can't make, but a producer can still respect. And it's kind of hard, you know, my wife says it's kind of hard being a different kid, you know? It's always been hard in high school, middle school, elementary school to be the different kid. And, you know, you picked on, you called weird, you this, that, and the third, but you know, that different kid is Bill Gates, you know? That different kid is Steve Jobs. So it's like, it's a hard road, but I mean, if you stick to it, it'll pay off. And so that's where my sound sits in that pocket. It's a soulful sound that both sides can understand, but it's still Knife. So just for an example of what I do, there's a guy that goes around that sells records to a lot of big beat makers, and he lives in Charlotte. So he goes around, because his dad has like 50,000 records, literally 50,000. So he goes around and he sells records and, you know, he'll come in my house and he'll say, I got a record and he has a record that sounds just like you. For example, I've never in my life seen this record at all. And I know a lot of records, but I've never seen this record. Osborne and Giles, 1985. So it's like, I got y'all the name. Okay, work on that. Okay, so it's 9 songs on this record, but he comes to me and says, Knife, this is something like you or you. So listen.
Hey, weren't you going on a mountain there just a while ago?
Okay, what I do is I take the record and
that's at the beginning of the song. Or the beginning of the original song.
So. Turn that into that.
Man, the name actually came from me writing down a bunch of names. I was in a history class. So I just put a bunch of produced by. So when I put produced by Ninth Wonder for it, It's a Wonderful World, I was like, that's it. And also I was a big fan of Digable Planets. And they had a song called Ninth Wonder. There's a scene in that video where Ish is turning the corner. You know, a butterfly from today is turning the corner, and he had on a Brooklyn t-shirt, and he said, I'm slicker this year. So I thought, if I can get my music and my whole persona, it'll sound and it cool as him turning that corner, and I got it. And so that's where I got Ninth Wonder from. So if you watch that video and listen to any of my music and see how I move as a producer, then you see where I get kind of my whole aura from.
Special, something more than special. I guess from the producer, like the way his drums are EQ'd, the way the chops are organized, and it's almost like painters, you know, producers are all like artists. So it's just like if you are a fan of art, you can discern between two artist styles, and it's hard to pinpoint it. There's little trademark things that every artist does that you'd be like, okay, that's his shit. Because I feel like beats, they show your personality, you know what I mean? And that, his beats, if you listen to all his beats, that's nice. We feed off of each other's energy, like when another producer does, that's how we all stay on point. So to have other producers in the game that you respect is important. I have to call Ninth or email him when I hear some new shit. Yo, what's the matter with you, man? The fuck is the matter with you, man? You know, I have to hit him with the, you know, what do you eat? What did you eat that day? What was the recipe? You know, because that's how we stay on point with each other, you know? I gotta hit him up and let him know I'm listening, man. Because that shit will send me home to make some shit. That's how we do it.
Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Whoa! That's my hometown. I love my hometown to death. My father built a house in Midway, North Carolina in 1977. With his bare hands. And my sister, who my studio is named after, that's the only memory that I have of her. I was holding her hand walking across the street to see this house. They always tell me that my sister took me everywhere with her. She was the one to make sure, and I see my daughter doing it now. Like, well, I go upstairs and my daughter is basically holding class with stuffed animals all on the floor. And my other daughter sitting down in a chair with pen and paper. Like, that's what my sister did. My brother said, man, days wouldn't have school, Bright Lady would have, she would have school on the porch. I named the studio Bright Lady because that's the connection I want to have with her. You know, everybody tells me she was a great person and, you know, Bright Lady this, Bright Lady that, so that's my sister. Born in 1964, passed away in 1977. My brother talks about it all the time. He said, man, we walked in the house and we flicked the lights on with light switch in 77. That was unheard of for us. We used to pull our lights. I had a childhood that was kind of, I got the best of all worlds, pretty much. My parents are 33 and 34 years older than me. So all their brothers and sisters were older. So I had a chance. My upbringing was a little different. You know, I got the old school, you know, way of life that way. With a garden, my dad had a tiller. And then, you know, we used to get vegetables out of the garden and stuff like that. Same time, my dad had a brother who lived in the inner city in Winston-Salem. And That's where I first heard hip hop. So my mom and dad listened to gospel music. They listened to James Cleveland and everything. But my uncle, who was my dad's younger brother, listened to Marvin Gaye's Sexual Healing. So I got both sides, but I kind of took all of that. And everybody knows it, you know, I meet a lot of people say, you seem like you're from the city. But when they hear me talk, I'm from the country. And when I eat, I'm really from the country. You know, when it's things that I eat and things that I, even the things, some of the things I say is,
barbecue.
It's so old school, you know, and I get it from my dad. So Winston-Salem is always in me, from Dewey's Bakery to Mountain Fried Chicken to you know, home of Krispy Kreme, home of Texas Pete, to R.J. Reynolds, where my dad worked at for so many years, to the school system where my mom worked at. So, you know, Winston-Salem is always, will be a big part of me always, period.
This is house I grew up in. This is Midway, North Carolina. And this is the house that my dad built with his bare hands. This is it. So, his patio, my room is up there. The basketball goal me and my boy Rob McKeever made, homemade, swoosh and everything. He has one in his backyard in Winston-Salem, but it's red and black. Mine was silver and black. We was in love with Nike like that. Ninth grade picture, boy. Trying to get it together with the turtleneck. Trying to figure it out. Couldn't get it together. Oh, you gonna love this. My man Randy Kilgore went to prom stag. Like, we ain't asking nobody to go, we just gonna go. So we went. That's my senior year. Went to the prom.
Shades on.
Come on, man. Couldn't stop us. We was unstoppable. Started with clarinet, man. Ended up on the drums. I'm playing like 6-7 instruments by the time I got to 10th grade. Dang it. Oh, snap. See what I'm saying? I got tapes. Tap the Bottle, Young Black Teenagers. Buck them down, How I'm Coming, LL Cool J single. I don't know what's on here, but we're gonna find out when I get in the car. I had a tape player, a Yorks boombox tape player right here. My shower, I used to listen to tapes every morning before I went to school. Encyclopedia, the words ring off the page. Like, I know this one. I'm gonna just turn straight to the page. And Mount Everest is the highest mountain in the world. It rises 29,028 feet. You see that? Did you see it? I read that so many times, man. It rises about 5 miles above sea level. It's the highest mountain in the world. It used to make me excited, man. It's like, wow, word. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I used to read. This came from a program I was in at Wake Forest called Project Ensure. And we was all selected out of the eighth grade to ensure us to go to college. And Jawanza Kanjufu was one of our instructors. He came to speak to us at 8:14. We had to read that. And we had to read that. A Raisin in the Sun. Lorraine Hansberry. We had to read these books at 13, 14 years old. This was my sister's book, too. See Evelyn Douthit? Wow. And this crazy thing, I remember I used to put my fingers like I was playing something when I was little. That's going with me, too. These trees, that tree, those trees. My dad planted those trees. And look at them. This is what keeps me sane. This is what's, you know, I know some people have formed their opinions about me. Some have. Some people think I'm a good person. Some think people don't like me. But this is what I know what type of person I am. This is what keeps me grounded. This. Because this is what I came from. So there's nowhere in the world you can act like you're bigger than anybody, or this, that, and the third if you came from this. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's no way. And it's quiet like this all year round.
See the dark, and I let my gun spark. Listen, every day I wake up, I'm thinking of something different. My life is just like a fizz, and I'm only here for a minute. Fuck it, I gotta get it. Nothing, I gotta give it. I'm doing a lot of business. Everybody dropping, just give me 100.
What you mean? No, it was the fast part was, I was like, I didn't want to do the obvious, so I did something close to that, which was wake up in the morning, I'm seeing just something different in life, it's just like a prison, the fuck it, I gotta give it, nothing, y'all gotta get it. And then the next one is the, I'm on fire, call me the moat, you know, molten metal, and that was the next to the regular verse. Let's play it.
Okay.
Every day when I'm on the streets, ain't no time to play. All I do is look up in the night, I don't see no light. All I do is see the dark, then I let my gun spark. I'm on fire, call me molten metal. It ain't my fault to settle. The shit I spit go through metal. I roll with the devil. Every dollar in my pocket from the flows I pedal. I'm on fire, call me molten metal. It ain't my fault you settle. The shit I spit go through metal.
So it reverses again, right? It starts with the fast part first,
yeah,
then it, okay.
And then I want you to drop it after I come from there when I go, let's go.
Okay.
Shit is essays rated, street approved in the jail like the essays rated. Let's go, let's go. Street approved in the jails like the essays rated. Let's go, let's go. Get lost. This bit, every day when I'm on the streets, ain't no time to play. All I do is look up in the night, I don't see no light. All I do is see the dark, then I let my gun spark. Yeah, I'm a murderer, a motherfucking killer on the loose. Y'all niggas is fiddling on the roof. I know I can't get mad at you, but I can't say damn, that's bad for you. Broke ass, cut a nigga severely. Fuck what you heard, y'all niggas hear me. I'm bullhorn, you bullshit, come on. Got bitches waiting on my lawn and my lawn. I walk at night like Spawn. Can't mess if yes, half y'all niggas is gone. Make moves, my shit is essays rated. Street approved in the jail like the essays rated. Let's go.
I was in the 8th grade at the time, and myself, Anthony Green, and Randy Kilgore were all at Hill Middle School. And we went to, separately, to an interview at Wake Forest. Went to Wake Forest, my mom took me to Wake Forest and to meet this man who was 6'5", 3", and some change, right? And I'm 14, I'm this 13, 14 year old kid. I'm gonna talk to this man, and it's something I didn't even know I was going for, man. I didn't know what, you know, at that age, it's all a blur, you know. And what you doing, man? I gotta go to this interview, man. I don't know what's going on.
Wake at the time was trying to become a national university, and they didn't have any programs for, you know, for students, or well, they had for faculty kids, but certainly not for minority kids. And so I said, hey, why don't you try this? And so we put together the proposal, sent it off to the Babcock Foundation, and they funded it, and they just said, okay, go ahead and do it. So I went around to the schools and started, you know, selecting kids in the second semester of their 8th grade year. And we kept them all the way through high school. And it was really about, at that time, also getting more minority kids, more African-American students. Wake had their self-interest. They wanted more African-American students to enroll here. And I was interested in having more African-American students go to college, period, and finish high school.
For a lot of us, the whole college atmosphere was kind of a foreign thing. I mean, you got some, you know, young men and women who come from a legacy of parents going to college and, you know, this, that, and the third, and uncles and aunts, it's been around the whole, everything to deal with college. But for some of us, our parents didn't go to school, you know, blue collar workers, stuff like that. So the whole college thing was kind of foreign. I mean, I was born and raised in Winston-Salem and had never been hardly to Wake Forest University. It's kind of like when you're on this campus, you kind of forget that you are in Winston-Salem. So just that whole aspect of being in a college atmosphere and seeing black students, you know, do well and excel and kind of gave you something to look at. Just all aspects of it, man. It was just it's changed everything for me. It gave me a worldview of things, a big worldview, you know, that are things that are bigger than Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
He gives me much more credit than I'm due, you know, because I used to fuss at him for bringing all these instruments to campus. I would say no TVs, no phones weren't really an issue. But he would always come with keyboards, and I would always fuss. I told you not to bring that stuff. But Doc, I don't care what you like. I said, but he would bring it, and he would always manage to talk me into letting him keep it. So you know, he just mushroomed, you know, just like so many of them.
And this happened around a great time where Do the Right Thing came out, and School Days was out, and the Cosby Show was on TV. Different World was 2 years in. So this is like the best time to be a 14-year-old. If you're gonna make a turn, this is the best time to take this turn. And the success rate for this program is probably 85% of us. We got 2-3 PhDs. We got a couple Juris Doctors. We got about 3-4 Juris Doctors. There's a girl who walked. She came up in a battered home and she walked to her interview from downtown Winston-Salem and walked back when she was 14. She is now the assistant director of UCLA's biology program. Like it's you can't even explain exactly what he did for us. And I wanna do it again. Like I wanna do the same thing for these kids, for kids coming up. Because it seems like the whole cool to be black and cool to be smart thing is coming back.
Flashback to 2003, summertime. I'm about to go to college. I'm about to go away for school. I just graduated high school, and I kept hearing about all these beat battles and all these and these rap battles that was going on up in Raleigh or Chapel Hill at this. What's the name of that club? 506.
It's the local 506.
506. 506 club. So I just graduated high school. I was producing. I was rapping. I thought I was better than everybody else in the world. And I also got this double XL. Somewhere along the line, they had this group called Little Brother from North Carolina. I was like, man, somebody from North Carolina's in XXL. So we started going up, me and Bomb Shelter, me and Nervous Rex started going up to Raleigh, to these Chapel Hill, to these beat battles. And Knife was always DJing. Man, I just used to stand in the crowd. You know what I'm saying? Like, just as a fan. I remember one day, he went to his car to play some beats for somebody, and I was just like the little kid that was in the background, like looking. You know, I'm like 18 at the time, 17, 18, I'm looking. Just listening to him play all his beats straight off his computer that he just burnt before he came. It was just, you know, incredible moment. So me, this is real Carolina family right here, man, you know. I know this guy's rooting for me like I've been rooting for him. Yeah, man. Look, man, this guy talking about basketball, there's been no proof of footage or any even word of him ever even touching the basketball.
Oh, we got it.
On the planet Earth. Y'all got it?
Yeah.
Well, this is about the time when we cut to that scene right now.
I started playing clarinet, which, coming from a tall black man with a beard and deep voice, me playing clarinet doesn't really go together. Just looking at me now, but I played clarinet. By the time I got to eighth grade, I was playing seven instruments. Anything that most instruments that reads the treble clef, and some even that reads the bass clef. The great thing about it was I had a chance to play these instruments and also listen to the golden era of hip hop at the same time, which is an incredible mix. To understand music theory, to understand the read sheet music and understand all of the you know, crescendo and staccato and all this stuff that you learn in music theory. And at the same time, listen to Brand Nubian is a crazy mix to do. It's funny that we're playing Carver right now, because see, Carver's the one that used to watch us play our little songs. You know what I'm saying? I had a band teacher, you mean Charlie Thompson was his name. Great band teacher, taught me a lot about music, a lot about music theory and everything. The problem was with Charlie Thompson is, he wasn't down with playing a whole lot of hip hop. You know what I'm saying? So we played a song called Land of a Thousand Dances. That's called, if you never knew what that song was, the name of that song was called Land of a Thousand Dances. We played that song. And that was our Get Hype song. But when we played Carver, the bad thing about it was, Carver, you see, we play our pitiful Land of a Thousand Dances song, and then they'll stand up and play They Reminisce Over You or something like that. And what'd be crazy is, like, soon as we done, and we know we have to, we woo! One dude stand up, a saxophone player stand up like this right here, and pull his saxophone out and be like, and then the whole band up. So we ain't play no hot jam, to be real with you. We ain't march like that either. We
I was an all county, all state orchestra and band. Once I got to ninth grade, you know, band suits wasn't cool, so I stopped doing the band suit. My mom brought me keyboard after keyboard. From seventh grade up to 12th grade, I think I traded in keyboards like cars. Like I was just keyboard, 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 keyboard. And I was playing stuff by ear that I didn't know that was samples. Because my mom and dad didn't have a lot of records, you know. It kind of came from the generation before vinyl really got popular in the 70s. I just got turned on to the whole world of stuff we heard in the background of these records was records from the 70s. Messed me up. I was like, what? You mean to tell me that they're taking music from the 70s and turning it into music from the 90s? And we loving this stuff. So what is these sounds that's in the background? Like, I need to know more about it. And shoot, man, 15 years later, 20 years later, man, I got almost 20,000 records. Staring, looking up like, what in the world am I getting all these records from? And it started from that. It started from sixth grade all the way up to now. And I can really attribute that band room for doing that, because I was just in love with music, man. Yeah, I didn't start actually producing rap records till I got 98, 99. I was taking a stab at it. I made my first beat in 1998. I thought it was garbage. I walked away from it and didn't return until the spring of 99. And then that day I made four beats. I did it in Leroy McDowell's room, 308 North Hall, NC State University. And then I was stuck over there every day. Like every day I'm trying to make a beat.
This thing about 45 is harder.
Thank you.
used to.
First time I heard Ninth, like, well, I'll tell you about the first time I really heard Ninth, because, you know, like, I'd been listening to Ninth prior to, you know, in many different formats, but the first time I really heard Ninth, which is a crazy story, is this is back when, like, WinZip was popping. Remember when WinZip was popping? And someone sent me this WinZip file of Ninth Wonder Beats, like, way back in the day, and I was just going through these beats, and they were all clearly at that time beats that I could never get or never afford, but someone had them. And so I used to listen to these beats all the time and write to them, and then try and get this other producer in Toronto to make beats that sounded like that.
What producer?
But I'm not gonna say his name.
Okay, nice.
But yeah, so yeah, that was like really the first time where I was like, I was searching for that sound, you know, and it like shaped a lot of the early music that I made and the music I make to date. I mean, obviously, you know, because it's led up to the point, but like early on, that was my life at one point, you know, Ninth Wonder and Slum and Little Brother and just all that whole movement, you know, and I wanted to be down so bad that I just kind of started rapping like that. Yeah, so I mean that's really my like beginnings, my Ninth beginning.
As it started, it was Fonte, Big Pooh, and Ninth Wonder. Started by the craziest of ways in 2001, recorded a song called Speed. And I looked at both of them and I said, man, I want to be a group. And Fonzie's like, well, it doesn't work. We always got Speed, but if it does work, we're on to something. And that was the beginning of it. And we recorded in Comanche's bedroom, The Listening, which took us from August to February to record. Some people say it's still our best record. It's a perfect album, almost, some people would say. And the way it was recorded on speakers that didn't even pan. And for people who don't know what pan means, if you put on headphones, you hear stuff in this ear, and you hear stuff in this ear. So stuff is panned to the left, and stuff is panned to the right. Well, these speakers, there were no pan. So I couldn't, had to gauge where exactly the pan went. So it took a lot of burn CDs going back and forth to the car to gauge it. Once I got it, that was it. So this is the way we recorded it, how we recorded it. Just the way it was put together was just an incredible feat. I don't think it ever be done again. Once in a lifetime. I don't even think we saw any of it coming. I don't think we saw what we were in store for or how our life was gonna change for better, for worse, or whatever. We had no idea. I try to tell cats all the time, don't go into doing music looking for a deal. Do the music. The deal will find you. Time went on. We did the Minstrel Show after that, which we signed to Atlantic. We signed on July 14th, 2004, which is, I looked at Fonte, I said, you know, today is French Revolution Day. This is Bastille Day. And he was like, only you would know some stupid stuff like that. But I said, yeah, this is, you know, maybe this is a revolutionary movement, who knows? And then through so many, you know, and I never talk about it, and I vow that I never will talk about it. But through so many miscommunications and so many, you know, this, that, and the third, whether it been me, whether it been Fonte, whether it been Pooh, whether it been whatever, Little Brother as three members is no more. Little Brother as two members still lives. Right? From whatever it was my fault in it, Tay's fault in it, Pooh's fault in it, because I never one time said that I didn't have a fault in it. But for whatever it is, we made some of the most incredible music, and we spawned a whole new generation of artists. I met so many cats that say, man, you know, I've been listening to LB since I've been 15. And I'm like, how old are you? 22. That person was Big Sean. Like, it's stuff like that, the people that we touched over the years, and we were the little engine that could.
The thing that the thing about me and Knife, you know what I'm saying, is that you know, we, in order for us to get to the point that we're at now, it just both took a lot of growing up on both of our parts. You know what I'm saying? We both just really had to just, you know, kind of take a long look in the mirror and really just, you know, face, you know, a lot of ugly stuff about yourself that you may not really want to. But that's just a part of being a man, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, during the time of, you know, when we were together as little brother, you know, we would, me and Knife was always, our bond was really always deeper than music, or than, you know, it really went beyond the studio. It was really just kind of sad to me because, you know, it wasn't really had nothing to do about the music. It wasn't about trying to get back as, you know, we gonna get back little brother. It wasn't about that at all. It was just really just about, you know, I lost a friend, you know what I'm saying? And during the 4 years that me and him weren't really speaking, a whole lot of stuff went down, and it just really gave us both more of an understanding about each other. It really brought a lot of things full circle because we both kind of had to humble ourselves, you know what I'm saying? He had to humble himself, you know, in order to talk to me. And I had to humble myself to listen, because in the past, that had always kind of been something that I think we both kind of struggled with. You know, Knife would never really want to talk about things. He would just kind of want to just keep it moving, and I wouldn't listen to people. I'd just be like, look, fuck it, I'm out. You know what I mean? And so we both kind of had to grow up a lot, and it happened when it needed to happen. So over the years, you know, it's really been just an evolution, you know what I'm saying? But at the core of it is just really still just, you know, Quante and Pat just laughing at shit and clowning. Like, that's real. I cannot make it no plainer than that. I mean, if we was to never record another song ever, I mean, it would just be us, like, clowning on shit. Like, that's really it, dog. Like, that's...
Welcome, Knife Wonder.
What's going on, brother?
What's up? Doing?
Man.
How you been?
You're the best DJ in the world.
Oh, man, come on.
Oh, God.
You're here already, dog.
He killed Atlanta.
I know you're working on a bunch of stuff. Yeah. I saw you in an interview with Drake. You're working on some Drake stuff.
Right.
Drizzy.
You stay with a nice medium between the underground and the mainstream.
Right.
Because you get that respect, you know, from the mainstream and obviously in the underground.
Blessed to have that, man. I just understand that soul music is soul music. Rap music is rap music. Whether you sell 10,000 or 500,000, mm-hmm. I don't let the album sales dictate who I work with. I if you're dope, you're dope. And some people are dope and don't have the means to understand and let everybody else hear that they're dope because they don't have the means and the money to get themselves out there, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. And so no matter what, in 2005, I worked with Beyonce and M.O.P. in the same year. Mm-hmm. That's what I want to be. And that's why I got, you know, Premier did the same thing. Dr. Dre did the same thing. Pete Rock did the same thing. So if I come from that family tree of producers, then that's what I wanted to be. So. Boy, I hate when I hear a sample, man. I've heard it for years. And
yeah. To pay the cable, you grinding here. The kitchen table's a white affair. Favorite Ninth Wonder record? I'm gonna say the Loving It Little Brother joint, which we was in Atlanta at MJQ's, and I put that joint on, and it was just such a great feeling, and it's a great, that's like a throwback vibe to like Tribe Called Quest and like, you know, the early 90s, 93 till infinity type of vibe, and you know, I think that's kind of what hip hop needs right now. So Ninth Wonder, do it again. Okay. We're gonna need another one of those out of you, buddy. So,
oh, the pressure.
You know.
Oh, the pressure.
Yeah.
How many beats have I made? Probably this summer, I probably made about 300-400 this summer. What am I thinking about? It's a high, man, that I try to chase. Every time, I'm going for that high, you know? There's a feeling in your chest that I can't explain it, but I'm trying to chase that every time. Sometimes I feel like I've hit it. Sometimes it may hit somebody else. I guess I'm chasing the same feeling that I got when I heard Electric Relaxation, or when I heard They Reminisce Over You, or when I heard Madism, or when I heard Who Got the Props, or The Blast. I'm chasing the same feeling, you know, like, what in the world is this? Like, that's what I try to chase when I make beats. And it's just, you know, it's repetition. It's like shooting jumpers. I mean, you shoot 1,000 jumpers a day, some jump shooters shoot 1,000 jumpers a day. It's the same thing with beats. You gotta make beats every day. If you can, make beats every day so it becomes like breathing to you. You know what I'm saying? Some beats just take 10 minutes to make. Some of my bangs I made in 5 minutes, you know? But that's what it is when it comes to the beat making. It's definitely like breathing. It's definitely a practice over and over and over and over. It's the foundation for all of this, making beats.
He chops samples, and but he does it, he catches those spots the same way where he's like, what the fuck is this shit that he's chopping up? And then he'll even take records that I've been messed with and manipulate them so nasty that it's like all of a sudden, I kind of want to go back to it and try to top him, but you know, I can't battle him, man. He's funky, and that's the bottom line. Let him have his funk. We're both James Brown, you know what I'm saying? That's James Wonder, I'm James Premier.
First it was Cool Edit and Hammer. Archaic. Then it was Cool Edit and Beatbox. And then it became Cool Edit and Fruity Loops. And I wasn't trying to prove a point by, I'm gonna make beats on computer and show the world. Like, I was just trying to make music. Like, I was trying to make music the best I possibly could. Trying to make some jams, man. It goes back to the whole thing when not overthinking, you know? I was at Jazzy Jeff's house one time, and I had my laptop up, and he had keyboards and beat machines and all on the wall, and I kicked out like 13 beats one day. He said, man, Knife, I came in here, man, with this little Hewlett Packard laptop banging out 13 beats. I'm here looking like Starship Enterprise, and I ain't got one out today. So that just told me that it's not the machine, it's the man behind the machine. I was in the studio with Destiny's Child, and Matthew Knowles walked in, and I had just made the beat for Girl, and Girl beat was playing. And I think Beyonce had already had a recorder, her first verse or something like that. And he listened to the song, and he was like, oh man, that's a smash. And Beyonce turned around, and she just turned into Dad's Little Girl like for about 5 minutes. She was like, guess what? He made it on that and pointed to my laptop. All he made it was on that, Daddy, on that. And I was like, man, can't a man alive tell me I need to change what I'm doing, you know? That's the whole Fruity Loops thing, man. I kind of shocked the world with it, man. A lot of people said, I can't believe you did it all on Fruity Loops. You believe it. I've run my Grammy off a program I downloaded off the internet. It says, present this a certificate to Ninth Wonder in recognition of your participation as producer on the Grammy Award-winning record, The Breakthrough, 2006 Best R&B Album at the 49th Grammy Awards. Actually, this is made out of real gold. That's what I was told, but this is it. I put in another frame, but to say that I have one of these and I can put this in front of my name is incredible to me.
He's got an incredible ear. You know, nowadays with technology and everything, it's pretty easy to take a record and chop it up and manipulate it, but really what it comes down to is having that ear for samples, having that ear for arrangement. And I can tell that Ninth Wonder is he's a true musician. Just the way he chops the samples and just his ear, man. He's got an incredible ear, man. And he just has, he paved his own lane and he created his own sound.
The first time I ever seen him make beats, it was probably like 40 minutes, like a 40-minute span. He made 4 beats within that whole time, and he didn't even listen to the whole sample. He was sitting there with the MPC, record player, and he just went through. He didn't even listen to the whole sample. Like, when I make beats, I'll play the sample. Okay, I can use these parts, and I'll go back through it like a million times. But he was just playing the song, and then he's like, oh, no. And then he just would drop it. He didn't even listen to the whole song. Dropped it, and then he's like, oh, wait, what's this part? And then just fucking went crazy on it.
The snare. I got about 10, 15 snares, man. Like, it's become the thing with me. I ain't changed his drums. And then when I started to change them, then you got people to say, man, I miss the old Ninth. As much as I try to run away from it, man, it's like, that's what the people want, man, you know? But I'm glad the people want that from me, you know? It's not like a sound that I'm making that some would say, oh, he's selling out. They want the boom bap sound from me, which is incredible to say. My biggest thing is I wanted to make beats and I wanted to get paid for it, whether it be $50 or, you know. And I was happy with getting beats for $50 when I was getting them, you know. I wasn't like, man, getting beats for $50. I'm like, man, I'm getting beats for $50. I'm banking, making I made $500 a day. I was sitting in front of this computer, just chopping up records. So, half of the stuff I've gotten, I would never thought 10 years ago I would say I've gotten. I'm just blessed for it, and I just keep moving. Here we go. We in business now. Let's see what we got here, Mr. Kenneth Price. So, I need some more.
gonna do? Right? 20. Everybody, 20 bar verse. 20 bars, that's all you need. We're gonna play this little deal at the beginning.
Track I did for Jay-Z on the Black Album, which was released in 2003. I received a call from a good friend of mine by the name of T. Smith. And T. Smith did the video work for Fade to Black, the movie. And he said, you remember I told you I liked your beats and, you know, whatever, you know, I met somebody in New York that you know, I would bring your name up. So I brought your name up to Young Guru. I was like, okay. And if the people don't know who Young Guru is the sound engineer behind Jay-Z for the past 10 years almost.
And I was like, yo, son, I don't know who you are, but this shit is incredible. There's no way that you're in North Carolina by yourself making shit like that. I said, you have to come play shit for Jay, you have to.
As soon as you walk in by the door, it's a leather couch and Beyonce's laying on the couch. So this is way before the whole, is Beyonce and Jay together? Are they not? You know, I saw this way ahead of time. Never said anything. You know, I guess it was a test of my loyalty or whatnot. But, you know, I went and sat down. And I sat right in front of him in a chair as he sat on the top of the CD rack. And I played 29 beats for him. And first two, he had poker face. That third one, he was done. Like, he was like, then after I played the first 29 for him, I was about to change the CD. He was like, oh, wait a minute. Go to 3, 6, 9, 10. He was naming numbers of the tracks.
So out of all them beats, Jay was vibing and vibing and vibing. But then he asked Knife, he said, yo, I got this idea for this threat shit with the R. Kelly shit. You think you can flip the beat? But he basically said it to him like, take that home and do the beat and come back. Knife was like, yo, hold on.
And he's like, man, I need something with a that bounce to it, you know. You know, right? And I'm like, all right, that's easy. He said, I got this song. He reached up, grabbed the CD, and gave it to me. He was like, see what you can do with that.
This nigga broke out just a computer. No beat machine, no little pads, no none of that shit. Fruity Loops, nigga. This nigga broke out a PC, and in 20 minutes, this nigga handed me the headphones and was like, yo, what you think about that? I handed that shit to Jay like, yo, that's it. Jay was like, yo, let's go, record that.
And so, he started, you know, on the rhyme or whatever, and he said, oh, go back. He's doing ad-libs in the beginning, he said, oh, go back. And then, when he went back, he started saying all these nines. Nine of them stopped, you know, whatever. Niggas must got nine lives. Then he said my name, and when he said my name, I just hung my head. And he's like, now you ready to make history, man? And I'm like, yeah, Jay, yeah. History. And so that was it, man. And I played my record for him. He's like, you think your record ought to make it? I said, you damn right I think my record ought to make it. He started laughing. And I think about 2 weeks later, my lawyer called me and said, I just got the paperwork for the Black Album. Congratulations. And that was it. I wanted to be a history teacher. That's what I went to Central for. I wanted to be a history teacher. I was a history major. You know, I felt like it was a void, you know, in academia when it came to just a study of the culture. I think that's the biggest problem with hip hop. We don't have a medium where we can really talk about the culture like it's supposed to be talked about. I taught 3 years in North Carolina Central. I talk from 1968 to 1997, because that's from the assassination of Martin Luther King to the assassination of Notorious B.I.G. And I did that because a lot of schools, they don't even talk about Black history between that time. If we want our kids to pay attention to it, why don't we tie it to music? Which throughout that course of time, you know, music has shaped this generation, especially the hip hop generation. So another gentleman by the name of Dr. Mark Anthony Neal, who actually wrote the book we were using in the class at Central called That's the Joint, came to me and said, look, man, I want you to come over in Duke University, and let's do something. And I'm like, oh, okay. And so we went to Duke and we taught a class called Sampling Soul. And that was a class where we just took a sample of every piece of the Black music diaspora, right? Sampling Michael Jackson, talking about Michael Jackson for 3 hours, sampling Illmatic, where we had 20,000 unique viewers on Ustream, sampling Geography, where I talked about Gambling Huff, Solar Records, Motown, and Stax, the difference, how, you know, in the Minneapolis sound, how it differed when it comes to Geography. You would think something that was started by us, not to say that we're the only people that's in it, but something that came out of our culture, something that came out of the Civil Rights Movement in the 60s, something that came from James Brown, we will be more intrigued to learn about the true essence of it. But Black schools kind of push that away. You know, they don't want to be attached to it because of what they see on television. They don't want to be attached to it. It's the same thing that happened to jazz, the same exact thing. We tended to, in the 60s and 50s, 60s, 40s, 30s, we wanted to push that away. That was the devil's music. We didn't want to be bothered with it, blah, blah. It was this worldwide phenomenon, and you know how jazz is now. I think a lot of us have the idea, since I'm Black, I don't need to know. I'm already Black. Why I need to know is it's called knowledge yourself, knowing where you come from, knowing where you say some of the words that you say, know where they came from, you know. Some people don't think that's important. And that was the biggest thing, the battle at a Black school. It's like, you don't want to learn about your own culture, but you go to this predominantly white school and you got a lot of white kids that want to know. They're intrigued to know, as well as their own. So it's kind of, that was the biggest difference between the two. I was a part of an art exhibit called The Record, and this is my section of the art exhibit. It's called Soul of a Beatmaker. And all of the records were, you know, supposed to resemble members of my family, or who could be in my family, or people I've seen over the years, and like, yeah, it looks like a cousin, or, you know, this is like a big family reunion of sorts, you know, from Curtis Mayfield to Bobby Womack to, you know, Tasha Thomas, like just different people. And so that's why I chose the records that I chose. Everybody had to have a theme, and my theme was, you know, it's called Soul of a Beatmaker. It's kind of dope, man. You can come and actually listen to, you know, my stuff. Funny to say that I have a exhibit here. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the thing that's funny, for me being where I'm from, to say that I have an exhibit in a museum. The internet has made the fan level go down. Everybody's a critic. Everybody's a critic, everybody's an A&R, everybody's a manager, everybody's a producer, everybody's a rapper. Like, nobody wants to be a fan anymore of just fans of the music. Although it helped my career push along in the undercurrent, you still just got that wave of people, man. You know, some people call them haters. I call them nothing to doers. You have nothing to do. Like, you know, you get on the net and you just want to bash. If I don't like your music, I'm not gonna waste my time talking about how much I don't like your music. Early on, it was hard for me to deal with, man, you know, because it's like there's a crowd on the internet that they want you to stay just to them. Once you become bigger than that, then you automatically suck. And it was hard for me to understand that, but that's just the way it is. Some cats just want to keep you all to themselves. They want to have, oh, you don't know nothing about Ninth Wonder. When we put you on, okay, so now once you get on, and maybe you turn on somebody that wants to turn their friend on, now it's like, he getting whack, he's selling out. Well, you wanted me to be, where's the glass ceiling? you want me to be big where everybody knows me, or you want to be just to the point where people know may not know me, so you can have something to talk about. So you have something over somebody.
I've made beats that's on the net, that kids are getting on the net. I got a Ninth Wonder album coming out. And this, my beats all over the internet. Coming out next on Twitter. Ninth Wonder album, me and Ninth, and next week, produced by Ninth. Right? We're in a culture that borrows from something else. We scratch on records, we paint on walls. You know, we sample, we records, this, that, and the third. All of that stuff was happenstance. All that stuff came from somebody in the 70s with two turntables, not close like this, one right here and one right here, and playing your favorite part of a record over and over and over. Example, if we don't sample, then you can't hear records like this. That song goes away. There's no more, you in the club with your girls. Beyonce, you know, song comes on, Crazy in Love comes on. Crazy in Love is over, it's done for that. Hit. I mean, listening to the sample, they did something to it. Like, they let that play in the beginning, and then they, you know, chopped it up when he started rhyming or whatever. But, I mean, if you take sampling out, you have no, hip-hop is gone. That's it. Yes.
You know, you got people on the internet that want us to keep going. Hey, why don't you keep making beats, Ninth? Why don't you keep doing this? And we can keep putting out albums. In order for me to keep doing what I'm doing and not getting a real job, you have to buy my music, for me to sustain a career, for me to not have to go get a real job, or to take away from, you know, I can't say a real job, a 9-to-5, would you take away from me making beats that you love? Like, it's all a circle, and people don't understand that concept.
Yeah, you know, on the internet, they got everybody kids, Ninth, Neptunes, Timberland, Swizz, Kanye, me, Just Blaze, everybody. So I went, I downloaded his shit, why not? Someone gave it to me. It's hip hop in its best form. B-boy, it's just soothing to the soul, man. That's all I can say, man. It's soothing to the soul, man. You hear it instantly. It is what it is, man. I can't, it's not over technical. Good music is good music.
Industry doesn't understand family, and family doesn't understand industry. If you say I gotta go to this recital, you know, some cats are like, you know, they can stay on the road all day and they can do this and they can studio all night, and which sometimes I still do, but they can just go leaps and bounds hard all year long without taking time off for themselves. And they can't even take time off for themselves, so you know they're not gonna be able to take time off for a family if they have one. The flip side of it is, sometimes your family doesn't understand it. In order for us to eat like we've been eating, I gotta work. And when you come from a 9-to-5 type culture, like North Carolina is, you know, some people understand they go to work at 9, they do their job, 5 o'clock, they leave all that paper on work on their desk, they go home. But when it comes to hip hop, and my job is it can be around the clock sometimes. You know, I'm my own boss. Sometimes I have to tell myself to keep going. Sometimes, you know, I don't know how to tell myself when to stop. But sometimes I'll be like, all right, it's enough. I'm not doing anything today, nothing. You live to regret the fact that if you miss something of your child's at a school, you know, that's burnt into that child's mind forever and ever and ever. And that's a lesson I had to learn with my son. You know, I wasn't ready for my son when he came. No 20-year-old is ready for a child. And I had to learn that lesson with him so I wouldn't make the same mistake. I don't even end the game. But I had to learn how much it means to be in a child's life And I had to learn it with him. And then I got it right the second time and the third time. So that's the thing about it. You just have to make it to the point where you just say, yes, no, I don't care what you say. Because at the end of the day, you have to make your own decisions. And you don't want to have to live with it. And I think I've lived with the right ones. Everybody just likes to say it's the industry that garners women. Man, all across the board, if you are confident in what you believe in, and you are confident in the position that you hold at the Dunkin' Donuts, I run the Dunkin' Donuts. Me. That's me, yeah. I'm in that Dunkin' Donuts all the time. Yeah, I know, because that's me. That's my Dunkin' Donuts. You know that? That runs, that garners some type of attention. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm a man, and if a dude, yeah, man, you know the Dunkin' Donuts on Capitol? And the one lower than that? Yeah, that's me. I run those, both of those stores. I open and close them. I'm grand opening and grand closing on both of those. That's me. Word? I'm like, word? That's all right. I'm a man. You know what I'm saying? So that's what it is.
I think he genuinely wants to make everybody happy. He's a people person. He likes to be liked. You know, he hates to be alone, and he's never going to be quiet. He's always on his phone or talking to someone, except for when, you know what I'm saying, we were taking a nap. That's the last man and in this heterosexual thing that I, like, took a nap with. Like, we both play with the kids, play Nintendo or PlayStation, and just pass out on the couch. You know, and his wife had to come in and clean up everything around him because we just pass out. Like, he works hard, and he gives so much of himself, and he wants to satisfy he's not looking for everyone's approval, but he wants everyone to be happy, and he wants to give everybody what they want from him.
Actual Proof, Rhapsody, The Way Team, Heather Victoria, Soul Council, Hollow, Tyler Woods, GQ, TP, Big Remo, The Tom Hardy, Skaza. That is my team. Jay-Z told me to, and I put you on so you can put your people on, and so on. It's called paying it forward, and so on and so forth. And so that's what, you know, I want to do. Just, he put me on, so now I want to put somebody else on. This is the program I've been running for the past 7 years. And it's you know, it did me fine. Not to say it's not going to be any valleys in it, but it, you know, some coaches have great seasons, some coaches have okay seasons. But, you know, I can honestly say my past 7 seasons, we finished in the top 10. You know what I'm saying? And we are always a national contender. So that's the way I look at it. And that's what I want to instill in my artists. Do I think I'm going to retire making beats for fun? No. Do I think I'm going to retire making beats in the industry? Yes. Because I don't, you know, I don't feel like a lot of times I'm built for this game. Money is not going to make me or break me that much. Some people, that's all they live for. And that's fine. I'm not wrong or right in either way, and neither are they. But, you know, I'm just, well, I cannot do this forever, like for as an occupation. Nah, because all the stress that comes with it is not even worth it to me. I just want to be a fan of the music and still have love for the music. I don't want to get to the point where I don't even love the music anymore. And once I feel like I get to that point, I'll just stop. But I won't stop until the artists that I have established something for themselves. I talked to my mom about it, and I said, you know, Mom, I want to come home one day and work for the school board. And that probably won't happen until I turn about 45, 50 years old. But it's something that I want to do. I like Winston-Salem when you're that age. You know what I'm saying? I think that's a great place to live. When you're, you know, in your 40s and 50s, and you just want to chill, and you can find your nice place in Winston to live, and it's easy living, you know. I want, you know, my kids to experience Winston-Salem South Carolina schools and high school. High school sports in Winston-Salem is very serious, probably most of, like, all small cities, but that's what I want to move back home for, so I can kind of give my kids the same feeling that I got when I was raised in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. And plus, you know, God willing, my parents are still around and I can be close to them as well, you know, in their older years. So that's some of the reasons why I wouldn't mind moving back home to Winston-Salem.
It's a beautiful day and it's a wonderful world of music. It's always smiles over here. We ain't got time for that, what to call N-I-G-G-A-S-H-I-T. We don't have time for that over here, okay? All right. I love you, babe. See, it's the groove in the record.
What is that?
People love and the one that people hate. The knife snare. 1, 2, 3, 4. Man, boys. Decide our own legacy. Be honest with you. When you lead a game, when you lead this earth, people will decide the legacy for you. We're just here to do what we're supposed to do. Everybody else to decide, you know, what was your legacy, or he was this, or he was that, or he did this, he did that. people are gonna decide that for you. You have no control over that, you know. I just wanna make the best music I possibly can. And it's in my realm, uphold the culture of hip hop, because so many people my age has abandoned it, maybe because of their lack of knowledge about it. But to uphold the culture of hip hop, because it is my culture. And that's about it.
Oh,